questions of religion, conflict and immigration are rarely far from the news headlines. I'm here with Dr. Erin Wilson, who's head of the Centre for Religion, Conflict and the Public Domain here in the University of Groningen in the Netherlands, which is having its five-year anniversary conference this month. This is to be the first in a series in which we examine the truth about religion and conflict and bust some of the myths that can be all too prevalent. Erin, thank you so much for being with us today and for agreeing to talk to us about such a topical issue.
Oh, that's my pleasure. Thank you very much for having me.
Erin, in the United States, President Donald Trump has tried to restrict migration from a number of majority Muslim countries. Is there any argument that introducing a large number of people with a different religion into a new society causes conflict in that society?
Conflict, I think, is taking it a bit far. You could say that it causes tension, but that's the same with any group of people that are different. So, I mean, the effort to restrict a particular number of people, as Donald Trump has tried to do, is based on an assumption about what it means to be Muslim, about what Islam is as a religion, also on the idea that particular countries are, in fact, Muslim countries. And the whole idea of a Muslim country is really a bit of a fallacy.
How do you mean?
Well, there's no such thing as being Muslim in the singular. There's no such thing as Islam singular. There are lots of different ways of being Muslim. There are lots of different ways of practicing Islam. There's lots of different denominations, if you like, within this broad category of Islam. And within these countries, there's a lot of different types of religions that are being practiced. A lot of people are atheists. So and the fact that the reason why Trump has tried to restrict it is because of a perceived link with violence. Not everyone in these countries is violent either. So to try and restrict these immigration on this basis is really informed by some quite false ideas.
Well, speaking of false information, I mean, if you or I were to take our smartphones from our pockets now and look up Europe and immigration and refugee crisis, we would very quickly find a lot of material that claims that there is a crime wave that's linked to mass migration. What's the truth of this? Is there a link between migration and crime?
No. I mean, there's been a study done in the United States that says that immigration actually reduces crime. In Australia, they've done a study that found that there was no difference in the crime rate amongst the immigrant population as opposed to the resident population. I know that this is an issue in Germany in the lead up to the election, but we have to think about the context here as well.
What context do you mean?
Well, I mean, a lot of immigrants when they first arrive in a country are not able to work either because their qualifications are not recognised or because of particular restrictions on their visa. They're also often not able to get an education, again, because perhaps their qualifications from their home country are not recognised or because they don't have the money or because, again, visa restrictions. So then what do they do to support themselves? How do they actually make a life for themselves? And sadly, sometimes that means that they resort to crime in order to support themselves and to support their families.
So is the solution then to allow them to apply for jobs? Would that not disadvantage native people?
Not necessarily, no. I mean, there's a lot of opportunities for work, and it's also about recognising the qualifications that people have when they arrive and saying that they have just as much opportunity to work as other people.
So what about terrorism then? I mean, is it not the case that we have had a large-scale migration into Europe, and at the same time, at least the public perception is, there's been a big increase in terrorism?
There's no direct link between immigration and terrorism. I mean, a lot of the acts of terrorism that we've seen in the European context have actually been carried out by people who've been born and bred in Europe. So there is, sometimes they do come from immigrant populations, but they've been born here and they've been raised here. So the question is more about how do we assist people who are already living in these countries to feel more a part of the community and to feel more like engaged citizens. So this is not a question about immigration necessarily, but more about what happens after people arrive and once their communities are established here.
Is that not just a time delay? Are we not just talking about, okay, well, maybe it's not the people who directly arrive with their children? Why is that any different?
But are you suggesting then that it's just immigrants who only commit crimes or who only commit terrorist acts? I mean, if it's just the people who arrive, that seems to suggest that there's some kind of genealogical link between immigrants. So if the first generation don't do it, then the second generation will. I mean, that just doesn't seem to make sense to me.
Not necessarily, but perhaps just the economic realities required to do that integration effort isn't realistic.
Well, but again, I would say that that's not just the responsibility of the immigrant population. That's also the responsibility of the resident population and the government that is allowing people to come and settle here.
So just following up on economic issues, as you said, it's very necessary to make sure that people are properly integrated and have opportunities to avoid problems like crime down the line. Now, Is that something that these countries that are accepting refugees and migrants are in a position to provide? Will it cause them financial problems down the line?
No. I mean, if there's been... Most refugees will repay the money that's invested into them within the first 5 years of arriving in a resettlement country. So all the money that, that governments invest in terms of language learning, in terms of housing, healthcare, all of these kinds of things, within 5 years, they pay it back. And that's because a lot of them get jobs, a lot of them will set up their own businesses, so they're putting back into the economy. But also, if you look at somewhere like Germany, and this has been widely documented, Germany's population is ageing and the birth rate is declining. They actually need immigration. They need migrants to come in and to work in their economy to support their ageing population. So it's not so much an altruistic decision as it is a pragmatic decision.
So speaking of pragmatism, how do countries best decide who should be allowed to come and join and live there? Why should we privilege people who are fleeing from conflict or war over those who want to, for example, just make a better life for themselves?
Well, I mean, it's a very political question, and there's a lot of ways in which we do privilege people who want to come and find a better life for themselves, but it's very particular kinds of people. So, I mean, I am in a way an economic migrant. I'm an Australian who's living in the Netherlands because I found a job that I really like in the Netherlands.
Same here.
But other people who are perhaps not as educated as myself or perhaps come from a different ethnicity don't have the same opportunities to come. And so then their options are far more limited. If we look at the question of refugees and people who apply for asylum, the refugee application process requires proving that you are a refugee according to the 1951 Convention definition. So the Convention definition in many ways is quite narrow. So there's a lot of problems with it.
So what are the implications of that?
Well, it means that people have to prove persecution. They have to prove that their rights are being abused. Now, sometimes that isn't easy to do because they don't have documentation of it, or the evidence that they have is circumstantial. It's not something that they've fled a conflict. It's not something that they've carried around with them in order to say, look, here's my proof of my persecution. But it's also, like, there's a phrase in the convention definition that says membership of a particular social group. I mean, what does that actually mean? And countries can choose to interpret that very narrowly so that they can exclude a greater number of people. But then the broader context, the realities of the migration process, of the flight, the journey as a displaced person, is that it's often very difficult to distinguish on the ground whether someone is a refugee or an economic migrant.
So in brief terms, what actually is the distinction?
Well, if you look at the migration journey on the ground, you could have a person who flees a conflict in Nigeria and ends up in a refugee camp in Jordan, for example, but because there's no prospect of work and it's unknown how long they will actually have to spend in the refugee camp before they're given resettlement status, they take matters into their own hands and they travel onto Europe to try and make a life for themselves. Now, are they a refugee or are they an economic migrant? It's very difficult to tell on the ground. The same thing can happen in reverse. Someone can leave Nigeria and go to Libya in order to try and find work and then get caught up in conflict there, and so they flee. Again, are they an economic migrant or are they a refugee? The realities on the ground are very difficult to make sense of.
Well, talking in terms of the difficulties that are presented when people arrive in the country, here in the Netherlands, there are many politicians who would actually frame this as a feminist issue. So they would say that Muslim communities who are coming to the Netherlands bring with them an oppressive ideology that oppresses women. What's the truth to that?
Well, I think this goes back to what we were talking about at the beginning. It's a very singular idea of what Islam is. There's a lot of Muslim feminists. There's a lot of women who are actually very active in the pursuit of human rights and gender equality in countries where we would see Islam as being very, very prominent. And also, I think the idea, like in France last year, for example, the burkini ban, like the idea that you tell women to take something off is just as oppressive in many ways as telling them to put something on. So we really need to be thinking about this in broader terms, and that it's not just about religion or a particular religion like Islam that oppresses women. There are also ways in which women are oppressed or excluded by other ideologies, including secular ideologies. So the question is not, is religion bad for women, but it's what ways are different structures, different ideas, different ideologies used to make women unequal in society.
What about this war between Islam and the West that other politicians talk about? Is there a direct link between religion and violence?
Well, I think the whole idea of a war between Islam and the West is just a very dangerous way of talking about this. There's no war between Islam and the West. I mean, how do we even know what Islam is? What is the West? What does it all mean? And it's just very inflammatory language. Is there a link between religion and violence? I mean, it depends on how religion is interpreted. It depends on what you mean by violence. It depends on the kinds of things, the kinds of violent acts that we're talking about, or the way in which a religious text is interpreted. A lot of different things. But look, really, the person you should speak to on this topic is my colleague, Dr. Joram Tarasarira.
And perhaps he can be our next interviewee.
Sounds great.
Dr. Erin Wilson, thank you so much for being with us. And do join us again next time when we will indeed talk to Dr. Joram Tarasarira about religion and its role in both conflict and peace building.